give them the center. The idea is, always make him come to the outside. So I cover, and I lift him up, and he's down. Even though it looks like he's getting hit really hard, just it's the body position, the timing. This kind of a feeling. That's all it is. So when he comes, if I can just cover, that's the key. That's all it is.
No.
Center, don't I? Don't do this, do I? Don't come over here. I'm taking the center. He comes. Everybody see? I'm taking the center. From here, after I've taken the center,
this last one. Seems like you come in.
that pain in your arm that helps you recover. All right? Any other questions?
On that last move, are you leading him elbow to elbow forward? Like your elbow comes underneath his elbow and extends?
No, no. Picture's worth a thousand. If this comes up here, you see, this is like this. Good? You keep the pressure on this one, you really have to. Because you've already stopped. But this kind of movement, it's right in here. You have to use the wrist and the elbow. It's like Shikonagi, you know? You have to use a tendon. Make sure that's what happened. Any other questions? I guess you all are hungry, huh? He doesn't have time to punch. I jammed his shoulder. He can't do anything. Can't get his leg out either. that because of the other foot. Let's try it again. I want you to see something. This is not this. It's not blocking. It isn't blocking. What it is sliding. Sliding. I'm not moving over because it takes too much time.
Right now, we're playing out here, we're going slow, nobody's
kind of kick, and women's hard punch, and women knows how to move in and out of it, you're going to have to work on it. When you kick, you know, everybody's legs are all over, but it's very simple. It's just like walking. Just, it looks, the most advanced kick is just like walking. This is like anything, because stand in front of you, feel it, and you'll know that it is something. You really know how to kick, it's just like that. Just like walking. Punching is the same thing. It's not this stuff anymore. It's just like walking. Show you one or two more kicks so that you can understand that you're going to have to deal with everything. The key with everything is you need to forget. I'm still going to do the same move, but he came sideways on me, so I had to move a little bit further out of my hip and lift him up a little higher. Maybe it's straight, maybe it's not. So rather than just come in here, I can do the same foot sweep. Coming behind him and drop. Everybody see? And so that's what we're going to do for now. We're not going to do the same foot sweep because you just did that. And I want to be able to show you something else. So he kicks to the side, move way over. From here, I will go up between his legs, drop and pin this, and take his hand. I might be pinning him in here. I might be pinning him in here.
Thank you.
hand stuff now just so that we can get in the habit of moving our hands. And I like to get it over with right away. Everybody see? If you can't see, come up here and stand up. Stick a hand out there for him. So hopefully he's going to grab that. When you see katate mochi, jyote mochi, all this hand grabbing stuff, how many people do you know will come up and grab you before they're going to hit you? Most people, they don't want to grab your wrist. They want to grab you by the neck or by the lapel. What I'm trying to do with a katate mochi, I'm trying to get him to grab this. He might be coming to grab here, but I'm going to stick my hand right in his. Do you understand the logic? I want to manipulate him from the time I think he's coming after me. From the time I think he's crossed that line, he's mine. His mind is mine. And that's the way you have to think. So he's coming for me. Okay? Everybody see? Watch slowly. What I'm going to do on this one is, I'm going to pin his shoulder. Okay. Does everybody see this pin? Okay, it's this one. It's quick. And the tendons on this side are not as strong as they get on this side. From here, let's go with the basics. Okay? Here's the basics. Now I can take the elbow, or up in the shoulder. Just the elbow. Everybody see? Let's try it back this way so we get another angle. Basics. We're going to try three of the same technique. The next one is under the shoulder. It's a different pin entirely that some of you should definitely experience. Next one, we're coming under the shoulder. Pin in here. Next one, come in here. Here, I'm going to roll I don't want them to hit your head. Punch the punch again. It's a double punch. I'm rolling it. Nice. Try it. What I do is I put the lock ID in his knee that he's resting on. I have a pin here. Any kind of a pin that I want. That one hurts too. Try that. Anybody want to feel this?
Thank you.
Tracy? Watch me slowly. Cover. So we have 10 minutes in Keiko, or now I have to start the question and answer, or we have time for one more waza, or? I'm going to do one more waza. And then we will informally go into question and answer. I want to talk a little bit about Koku Nage. A lot of people here today, when I first came in, thought that Aikido was magic. And you go like this and you can fall. Really not true, and it's especially not true because the people you've been with weren't giving you a real attack. When you practice Aikido at your own level, you attack as hard as you can, as long as you understand that your Aike, in other words, you take them to their best limit, and if they are better than you, let them take you to your best limit. You understand? You make them attack a real attack. So in other words, I can practice with my 3-year-old daughter or my 16-year-old son, doesn't matter because I fit their highest level. But you have to get a real attack. When you're getting a real attack, the magic will start to work for you in a way. Koku, more than anything else, is timing, your mind being able to lead and float them, and body position. I want you all practice three things. One, you've seen that. Two, you've seen that. Three, you haven't seen that. Okay, these three things, another, the last one is this. You should come in the middle, offer something, and turn. Offer this, up a little.
Punch me. Aye! And I do that. That's not a word.
That's a sound that he felt, and he felt it in here, and he felt it in here. Some of you felt it in here, some of you didn't. The power of sound can be used in a lot of different ways, but Kototama also engulfs holy words and actually unholy words and sound. And Kototama can be used for healing or killing. It is like any other magic, it can be used both ways. Okay?
Could you describe a little bit the focusing of some of what you do and as you begin to prepare a new technique? It seems like you're going through a very specific focusing process.
It's a cycle. And I don't know where the gentleman is that I was throwing back here for a minute.
Steve
Burns. Yeah. Did you come up there as one of the instructors? You probably are though, aren't you? Should have been up there, you're too humble. Where you teach? New York? San Jose. When I play, when we just are showing things, it's just body position. When you really throw, you'll get into a hum, you'll collect yourself, and you'll start to culminate energy. You set them up, you grab their key, you grab them from way back there. And you take them, and you bring them to you. And then right when they come to you, so it's like lightning. And Oni Saburo, who as you know was Osensei's teacher, wrote the kanji, Bu Kangari, which means Budo is lightning. And it's like lightning, a combination of electricity and power between heaven and earth, and an explosion of the earth. That's really what Buke is. That makes sense?
On the other side of that, what sort of things are you looking for, or what sort of, how should the Uke be setting up to take all of this?
Uke should not be thinking about taking anything, nor should he be thinking about the Izuke. Uke should only be thinking about attacking. And in advanced stages, you're not even thinking about attacking, you just attack. Musubi simply means to become one.
Very simple. It's a relationship between Uke and Nage.
It can be. I can say Musubu in 50 million different ways. It's like taking the word marriage in.
Would you elaborate on
you
said you don't breathe?
Yeah, I'm not going to throw him, I'm not even going to do any technique. He's going to attack, okay? He's going to attack. You see when I stop and try to do that? You probably can't see it. Become in slow motion. Now, and attack me in slow motion. Now, let's try that. Another subject can see something else. Now. I never breathe during one confrontation. And in multiple attacks, when I'm doing 3, 4, 5 people at a time, I'm breathing very, very slightly between people. This is the way I do it. I'm not saying that you're sensitive to you. Can you tell me to say something?
So why don't you?
Because for me, the epitome of my power is in a position where I am all together flexing and bringing everything together. It's more of an exhale. You inhale when you want to bring somebody in. For the gravity. Once you get that, you can't be inhaling because they can touch you. You feel that? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I don't know how to word this properly, maybe, but maybe I'm reading the motivation and the proper state of mind to have, like, get my old ways of fighting and that, to have the proper thinking, not to draw back, not to go forward, to wait.
You know, I think meditation, understanding that when you become one with all things, you develop a spirit like a mirror that is a perfect and accurate reflection of all that is. When somebody attacks great evil, you you reflect that, that greatness will come back onto you. You are not God, but you become one with God, and you allow God to be the judge of how that energy will come back at you. In other words, if somebody attacks me out on the street, I don't think to myself, I'm going to get this guy and I'm going to kill him. I don't think at all. I just react to that specific energy. And I do what I have to do in accordance with that. And like I said to you earlier, in the scope of things, whether I have to take a life or save a life, ultimately there's no difference. I would rather save a life. You know what I'm saying? But if, for example, this guy at Ramirez, what was he called, the Night Stalker, if I was standing in the middle of the street and I saw him going to cut someone in his throat, and then he did, and then he went to kill me, my reaction might be to terminate him. I would feel mad afterwards by taking him life, but I don't even feel like it would be my decision. It would be an act of my training in relation to action and reaction in terms of force and levels of negativity. Does that make any sense to you? I would rather be nice, as I said earlier, but if I have to not be nice, I'm very prepared to do that.
What you're essentially saying is, if you're being nice, you're not being nice, you're just reflecting what's there. That's what I'm saying.
Trying.
In relation to healing, do you have a similar attitude? I mean, do you have a similar kind of
Well, it's very different and only similar in the sense that I don't treat too many people anymore, and the only people that I treat anymore are people that I feel want to be better and have a kind of karma with life that I can understand or appreciate. In other words, if somebody comes to me who has a bad heroin habit that thinks he wants to get better but knows he's not going to, I'm not going to treat him anymore. But if somebody in this dojo today came to me and said, I'm having a problem with my ovaries, and I felt that this was a person that really wanted to get better, I would treat her. You see what I'm saying? I look at the individual, and I see what I can see from them, and I make a choice.
Your experience
with those things,
too?
I had a very, very little experience with those things. I was able to see them several times with a great speaker, and I was very close to the spiritual teacher, as I still am. I think I was probably the only white person to ever go exactly the footsteps of all this in terms of his mystical training. I became a priest in all over the film. I could always set a chain with the priest that O Sensei was raised. I never really knew him and I never got to him. But they could go on that, so they could go out on without any of
them. Where did you start?
I started karate when I was, between 7 and 9 years old. I went to Detroit in New York. And then I came to California and found somebody. I was in Japan for a time with my father and saw Aikido there. Continued to study karate. Got to the point where I became interested in Aikido from Singo Sensei, things that I heard about him. Found somebody in the Los Angeles, Southern Los Angeles area, who was teaching me to study with a lot of farmers and the season. You just, don't go to these little stabs at this and that, but when you get to seeing a lot, you'll see always cutting with the feet, with the hands, from asabaku, asabaku, the hands, the feet, angles, it's all painful.